Well, good morning and welcome to our Easter service here at St. Luke's. Christ is risen. And you say, he is risen indeed. Now, can I just say, it's a whole lot more fun when you're all here with me and you all say that loudly back. But since we can't do it together this morning, perhaps you could find someone near you and choose someone to say the first part and someone to say the second. And if you're by yourself this morning, well, you'll just have to go with me. But perhaps later on in the day, you can call someone up and say, Christ is risen, and see if they were watching and see if they respond, he is risen indeed. Okay, everyone got somebody? You know which part you're going to do? Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Mark chapter 16, verse 5 says, as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. Don't be alarmed, he said. You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. Let's sing together that wonderful Easter hymn, Jesus Christ is risen today. Well, it's always good to take a moment, particularly at Easter, to remember all the things we can be thankful for. And particularly at the moment when things can be hard and difficult, it's really helpful for us to take a moment, take stock, and think about the things we can thank God for. Kids, what are you thankful for? You could tell your parents now something that you're thankful for. You might be thankful that your parents have been doing such a good job at the end of last term teaching you. Or perhaps you might be thankful for those teachers that you have normally and how good they are. That might be it. We're really blessed, aren't we, to be living in a country like Australia at the moment, where we've been protected so much from the devastating effects of this virus. That's something we can be really thankful for. Thankful for our health system and the way we have been looked after. Perhaps you're thankful for a kind neighbour, for our caring church. What is it you're thankful to God for this Easter morning? Let's say this prayer of thanksgiving together. It's going to appear on your screens. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we humbly thank you for all your gifts so freely given, for life and health and safety, for work and rest and friendship, and for the wonder of creation. We thank you for preserving throughout history a people for yourself. Above all, we praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his death and resurrection, for your life-giving Spirit, the hope of sharing in your glory. Fill our hearts with all joy and peace in believing, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And speaking of being thankful, perhaps you were lucky enough to get some of these. Have you spotted them? How many can you spot? There should be 7 of them. Let's see if you can find them. There's one there. Now, I'd love to take you on an Easter egg hunt like we did last year. But I do have 2 volunteers here that are happy to help us find them, and I promise they won't eat them all. Let's see if we can get them. Na 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 na. Boss of the cross bore the sin and the shame when he suffered and bled and lay down with the dead. But the Lamb who was slain rose up again. It's the hope of the lost. He's the boss of the cross. 'Cause sin didn't stain him, death didn't claim him. He rose again, he is boss of the cross. See God raise him, everyone will praise him. Mighty Jesus, boss of the cross. Na 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 na. The cross bore the sin and the shame when he suffered and bled and lay down with the dead. But the Lamb who was slain and who rose up again is the hope of the lost. He's the boss of the cross. 'Cause sin didn't stain him, death didn't claim him. He rose again, he's boss of the cross. See God raise him, everyone will praise him. Mighty Jesus, boss of the cross. Well, that was a bit of fun. I'll see if I can get the kids to hang on to some of those Easter eggs so we can share them out when we can all get back together again. And it really is something that I'm missing about this, having all the children together from our church. And I know that Lynn is missing it as well, but she really wants to involve the kids in these services. And she's been sending things out to them. And she's got a message now for all the children.
Hi, kids. So pleased to have you here in our church service today. And we have a special Easter video for you to see. It's so important to remember Jesus, isn't it, at this time of the year? Particularly on Easter Sunday, when we think about him coming alive again. He didn't stay dead after he was killed. So watch the video, and when you're finished, I'd like you to collect from your parents the sheets I've sent for you to work on. Find a spot somewhere at a table nearby and complete them while your parents watch the rest of the service. At the end, we're going to have a Zoom meeting about 10 minutes after the service, and if you'd like to come to the Zoom meeting with your pet folk, we can have a look at what you've done. I'd love to see your craft work. So maybe I'll see you later, but watch this now. Bye.
Jesus knew he'd suffer. He knew he'd be betrayed by a friend. And he knew he'd die. It was all part of God's plan. Jesus breathed his last breath, bowed his head, and died. God's plan was that his son would die for the world he loved. A man named Joseph took Jesus' body down from the cross. Nicodemus, who'd visited Jesus in secret, helped Joseph. They wrapped Jesus' body up and took it to a cave called a tomb. The tomb was in a garden. No one had ever been put inside this tomb before. Joseph and Nicodemus placed Jesus' body inside the tomb. A big stone was rolled over the entrance of the tomb. God's only son had died on a cross, and now he lay dead in the tomb. 2 days later, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb. It was very early in the morning. Everything was still dark. When she arrived, she saw that the stone had been rolled away. Immediately, she ran back to tell Jesus' disciples. She cried, "They've taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." When Peter and John heard what Mary had said, they ran to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away and Jesus' body gone, just as Mary had said. Inside the tomb, they found the strips of cloth Jesus had been wrapped in. Peter and John went back to Jerusalem, but they did not understand what had happened. Mary stood outside the tomb and wept. As she cried, Mary looked inside and saw two angels sitting where Jesus' body had laid. The angels asked, "Why are you crying?" Mary cried, "They've taken my Lord away and I do not know where they've put him." Mary then turned and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but Mary did not realize that it was him. Jesus asked, "Why are you crying? Who are you looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, Mary cried, "If you've taken my Lord away, please tell me where he is." Jesus then said her name, Mary. It was only then that she realized who he was. It was Jesus. Mary then ran to tell the disciples the news. Jesus is alive.
Well, isn't that great news? Jesus is alive. And don't you wish you could draw like that? Wouldn't that be fantastic? Before you go off, kids, to do your craft and colouring in, we're going to sing a kids' song together, "He is Alive," by Colin Buchanan. Let's sing this together.
Sunday morning, the women come to the grave of the crucified Jesus. The stone is rolled away. They hear the angels say, "He is risen, hallelujah. He is risen, hallelujah." Peter, hurry, Peter, run to the grave of the crucified Jesus. Strips of linen, an empty tomb, but Peter, you will see him soon, because he is risen, hallelujah. He is risen, hallelujah. Two brothers walk in the Emmaus Road, they're talking to the crucified Jesus. When he broke bread, they knew all Jesus said was true, because he is risen, hallelujah. Glorified Jesus, he crucified our sin, and we will rise like him too. He is risen, hallelujah. He is risen, hallelujah.
Good morning. Our reading this morning for Easter Sunday is John chapter 20, verse 1 to 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary?" She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. Here ends the reading.
Who is it that you're looking for? This is what Mary is asked by Jesus. Who is it that you're looking for? And at the time, she doesn't really know. But what she found changed her life forever. Who is it that you're looking for? What is it you're looking for? We could put a list together, couldn't we, of the things that might change our life. Well, at the moment, if we could find a vaccine to the coronavirus, wouldn't that be amazing? Lives saved, we could get back to our daily routines. But let's just say we've got that on the top of the list. What next? What's something that might help us through this time? Perhaps a new subscription to a movie streaming service, that'd be good. Or a DVD collection like Gary O'Connor's, that would be fantastic to help us through. What would make our life better? But to be honest, a lot of the time, we just don't know what it is. That one thing that could help make life better. And in fact, the marketers know this insecurity in us, and they love to play on it. Those ads we see on TV, painting a picture of this one thing which will make our life so much better. that we could have the perfect life if we just get that perfect backyard or that perfect car or that perfect one thing which would make our life better. What happens if I told you that Jesus could change your life for the better? But he doesn't just want to change one thing. He doesn't want to tinker with your life. No, Jesus changes everything. We're going to see that this morning, looking at three things that Jesus changes in us when we meet the risen Lord. Firstly, he changes what we trust in. We're going to see this in the account as Mary goes to the tomb. Chapter 20, verse 1, Jesus changes what we trust in. Verse 1, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene, she goes to the tomb and she sees that the stone is gone. What's happened? Well, maybe someone's taken the body, she's thinking to herself. So verse 2, she comes running to Simon Peter and the other disciples, John, and then she says to them, they've taken my Lord and I don't know where they've put him. So what do they do? Well, Peter and John, they start running for the tomb. Now, John's a bit faster, so he arrives there first and he's kind of looking around. Where's Simon Peter? But he's not coming. And so he then starts to peer into the gloomy darkness of this cave where the stone has been rolled away. And then Peter turns up, and what he lacks in speed, he makes up for with his usual brashness. And he just goes charging in, walks right into the tomb. And what does he see? Verse 6, he saw strips of linen lying there. And now he goes inside, he can see something else. He can see the cloth that was wrapped around Jesus' head. And it's as if the body has just gone right through it and the strips have been left there. And so now Peter, he's calling out to John. Probably not calling out, he's probably whispering, because that's what you do when you're in a dark, scary place. So he whispers to John, hey John, psst, nothing. So he calls out a bit louder, hey John, get in here, you got to see this. So finally John walks in, and then we read this, verse 8, he saw and believed. What did he believe? Well, he believed that Jesus is risen. I mean, what else could he have come to the conclusion at that point? Of course Jesus is risen, but that's not what this verse means when it says he believed. He believed in something else, something deeper. He believed in Jesus, in who he was, in everything that he'd ever said to him. John now believes all of it. In that moment, his shattered faith is suddenly rebuilt around Jesus. Jesus changes everything. If you meet the risen Lord Jesus, you put your trust in him. Why? Well, he's the one that's crossed from death to life. And you trust him because, well, that makes him the expert on life. The one who's risen from the dead is the expert. Let me give you an illustration. Just say I head down to Wollongong Airport and I'm taking one of these smaller planes flying down to Melbourne. And we take off, and then I see one of the air stewardesses coming up to me, and they stop right at my seat, and I'm a little bit concerned. And I think, oh, maybe I'm doing something wrong. I look around, I've got my seat buckled, that's okay. My tray's up, it's all good. I say hello, and she says, hello, Mr. Chaplin. And I'm thinking, oh, Mr. Chaplin, that sounds good. She says, the captain has requested you coming down to the cockpit. I'm thinking to myself, this is amazing. I get to go into the cockpit. So I unbuckle my seat and I walk down. And there, you wouldn't believe it, Phil Crocker is flying the plane. And he says, g'day, Simon, how are you doing? Come take a seat next to me. And I sit down and he starts to show me all the controls. And I'm thinking, this is fantastic. And he goes, you want to go down? You push this forward. You want to go faster? You turn that knob there. He goes, why don't you have a go? So I grab the controls and turning left and turning right. I'm thinking, this is fantastic. And he goes, listen, Simon, we're about to come into land. Why don't you have a go? I'm like, sorry, what? Yeah, you have a go landing the plane, no worries. At that moment, I am out of there, straight back to my seat as fast as I can. Why? Because I don't want to be in control of that. I want the expert to be landing the plane. And this is what Jesus is. Jesus is the expert on life because he's crossed over from death to life. And he can tell us how to live now. So what do we need to do? Well, stop trusting in anything else in this world. Stop trusting in ourselves. Start trusting in the expert, the one who's raised up to life. That's the first thing. Jesus changes what we trust in. Secondly, the risen Jesus changes our very purpose in life. Where's your life going? What direction are you going in? We see Jesus radically change the direction of Mary's life in this encounter. Let's have a look at it together. Verse 11. We're taken into this really intimate moment here. In verse 11, we see that Mary is standing outside the tomb crying. And two angels are there, and so they ask her, they say, "Why are you crying?" Now, she takes that question literally, but it's not a literal question, "Why are you crying?" By that, they mean, there's no need to cry. Why are you crying? Jesus is alive. It's all good. But taking that question literally, she says, "They've taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they've put him." And then verse 14, at that moment, maybe she hears something or senses the presence of someone, because she turns around and there is Jesus standing there. But for some reason, maybe because the tears are in her eyes or perhaps through disbelief, she doesn't recognize who he is. Gives Jesus the opportunity to gently probe into her thoughts. And so he digs down and asks her, "Who is it you're looking for?" There's that question. And Mary once again takes this question literally. And so verse 15, thinking he was the gardener, she says, "Sir, if you've carried the body away, tell me where it is." But Jesus is not asking a literal question. He knows who she's looking for. His question is more like this: what kind of Messiah are you looking for? Are you really looking for the kind of Messiah who would be defeated by death? Who would be destroyed, kept into the grave, sealed into a tomb? No. That's not the Messiah. Now, Mary, the most devoted disciple, even her picture of Jesus, of the Messiah, is too small here. But Jesus is about to blow that away, because meeting Jesus changes everything. What kind of Messiah is he? Who should she be looking for? The one who overcame death. But Jesus doesn't say any of that. He just simply says one word, and that's enough. Verse 16, he says to her, "Mary." And in that moment, she knew. She rushes forward and clings to Jesus. She knows now that her life has new meaning. Her life has new purpose, because the risen Jesus changes our purpose, because he changes everything. Which is a great diagnostic question that we can ask ourselves. What changes has Jesus made to us? If Jesus is just kind of like an add-on to our life, turning up on a Sunday morning, or it's even easier now, just flicking on our YouTube channel, turning up on Easter. Or another question is, are there parts of our life that are off limits to Jesus? You know, Jesus will let you control this part, but not that part. We'll let you have access to this part, but not to my heart. No. And Jesus changes everything. as he gives us a new purpose in life and a new direction. Well, thirdly, and briefly, we're going to see how he does that. How he gives us a new purpose? Well, thirdly, he changes our relationship with God. He restores it completely. Now, that's what he's doing here. That's what he's doing in this moment. Now, it's a common misconception. In fact, the most common misconception about Christianity, that we've got to do something first before we can be accepted by God. It's like there's this ladder, and getting up to God is about working our way up the ladder. But you'll notice that Jesus is the one who comes down to us. You see, he comes to Mary before she understands, and he lifts her up. He changes her. And that's what Jesus can do for us. That's what Jesus can do for us this Easter. He can lift us up. And he can change us from the inside out. How? By restoring our relationship with God. Taking death and crushing it. Taking our sin and forgiving it. Making us new once again. How? Simply by accepting Jesus as Lord. So let me conclude. Jesus changes everything, and he can change everything for you. He can change what we trust in, change where we're going by restoring our relationship with God, his Father and ours. Amen. Well, we're going to pray now, and I'm going to ask Pam to come up and lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. A prayer for Easter Day. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. A prayer for our world. Sovereign Lord, you are the hope and healer of your people and have promised a world where there is no more sickness or crying or death. By your death and resurrection, you have set your people free from the penalty of sin and death. We pray your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Please prosper the work of those who are seeking a vaccine for the coronavirus. Please strengthen those who are treating the sick. Please comfort those who are mourning the loss of loved ones or living in fear of this disease. Please give to governing authorities wisdom in their management of this crisis. And give to your people your peace beyond understanding, generous and wise hearts, and a renewed trust in your sovereign goodness and glory. Turn the hearts of many now experiencing fear and anxiety, that they may find that peace which is the fruit of the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Father God, we thank you for this joyous new Easter Day, where we can count on your goodness to us, your love and faithfulness to us, and your promise to be with us forever. We are so grateful for your grand plan to send Jesus to our world, to die in our place, to declare us forgiven for our wrongdoing, thus enfolding us in your love. We bask in the joy of your presence with us forever and the promise that death has been defeated. We look forward to the day when we see you face to face, and all for Jesus' sake. Amen.
sting of death. Sing, sing hallelujah. For joy awakes as dawning light when Christ's disciples lift their eyes.
Well, thanks so much for joining us this Easter service. And I really do hope you've enjoyed it and been encouraged by it and been able to take something away with you. But I really would hate for us to miss an opportunity that is with us at the moment. We really are in a unique moment in history. And I think it's providing us an opportunity to perhaps ask questions we haven't asked before, or at least not for a long, long time. And those questions are, what is our relationship with God? And have we let Jesus change everything? Have we given the steering wheel over to him and let him change the course of our lives? Now, perhaps you have some questions about these things, and I'd love to be able to help. And there are a few ways that we could do this. You could drop me a line via my email address, simon@berryanglican.org. And there are some courses which we're running which would be really helpful to explain and answer some of your questions, explain about who Jesus is in perhaps a deeper way for a deeper understanding than you've had before. Christianity Explored is actually putting an online course on its website now for free. You can do this at home and by yourself in your own time. It's a really high quality series of DVDs with engaging material that goes with it. And you'll be able to find a link in the comments below this video. But it might be better to do something like that together with a group of people, and I'm going to be hosting an online course exploring who Jesus is, and it'd be done in a fun, non-threatening way, and it's really easy. You don't have to go anywhere, and you might have a bit of extra time. Drop me a line if that's something you're interested in, and we're going to be setting them up on Mondays in the afternoon and in the evening if that suits your time. And if those times don't suit you, we'll probably be able to tailor a course to you. Well, a few other things. Straight after this service today, we're going to be having a virtual morning tea via Zoom. I'd love you to join in, and particularly if you're not a regular part of this congregation, but you just want to drop in and say hello and share your experience of joining in this morning. If you're watching it live, well, now at a little bit past 10 o'clock, we're going to be meeting together over morning tea on Zoom. And again, you'll find those details. If I sent you out an email, they'll be there. You can just click on it or in the comments below. And I'd love for you to drop in and say hello. The office is going to be open tomorrow, as usual, 10 to 11, where you can drop in and say hi and drop off anything you need to. Also, you can pick up things there, like the news sheets, if you haven't been getting them, you can do that there. Also, you can pick up DVDs of these services, which is not going to help you because you're watching it, but you might be able to grab one for a friend and pass them on. So we'll have DVDs of the services there tomorrow. Well, I say, Christ is risen, and you say, He is risen indeed. Thanks so much for joining us this Easter Sunday, and God bless.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, the solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones He came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. On Him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave He rose again.